Let's have another look at converting roll pitch yaw angles to a rotation matrix. We use the function that we introduced a moment ago, RPY to R, and I'm going to pass in a roll angle of 0.3 radians, a pitch angle of pi on 2 radians, and a yaw angle of 0.5 radians. And as before, we have an orthonormal rotation matrix. Now I'm going to convert that back to roll pitch yaw angles. To do that, I use the inverse function, TR to RPY, and I pass in the rotation matrix that we just computed, and here are the roll pitch yaw angles. You'll notice that they are quite different to those that we passed in. The middle angle, the pitch angle, is the same, it's pi on 2, but the roll angle has changed from 0.3 to 0, and the yaw angle has changed from 0.5 to 0.8. Now if you're sharp, you'll have noticed that 0.8 is the sum of 0.3 and 0.5. So one of our angles has gone to 0, the yaw angle has gone to the sum of the original roll and yaw angles. What's going on here? Well, this is a condition known as singularity, and it occurs in any three-angle sequence representation of an orientation. It occurs for roll pitch yaw angles, it occurs for oil angles. It always occurs when the middle angle takes on a particular value, and for roll pitch yaw angles, the pitch angle is equal to pi on 2, leads to the singularity condition. This condition is also known by the rather unusual name of gimbal lock. If you've ever seen the movie Apollo 13, you will have heard that term used. Apollo 13 is actually one of my favorite movies. It's a dramatization of the very famous Apollo 13 mission to the moon back in 1970.
Okay, Houston, we've had a problem here.
What's the matter with the data?
Houston, say again, please.
Okay. We got more
problems. Houston, we've had a problem. We've had a main beam bus undervolt.
There was a faulty component built into the spacecraft, and eventually that caused a massive explosion. The moon landing was aborted, and the astronauts were really lucky to get back to Earth alive. The explosion presented the astronauts and the NASA ground staff with all kinds of problems, saving the crew's oxygen, removing excess carbon dioxide, dealing with power shortage, and devising a strategy for getting the astronauts safely back to Earth. A rather more obscure element of this dramatic crisis is gimbal lock. It is a pretty esoteric term, it's a very geeky term, and I'm pretty sure it's the first and perhaps the last time it will ever be mentioned in a Hollywood movie. The problem was first of all picked up by the ground controllers as they monitored the crew who were trying to stabilize the stricken spacecraft.
13 Houston, we see you getting close to gimbal lock there. We'd like you to bring up all quad C's on main A, quad C1, C2, C3, C4 on main A, and also bring B3 and B4 up on main A.
The pilot was trying desperately to keep it away from the gimbal lock condition.
13 Houston, you read?
Yeah, we got it.
Okay, can you tell us anything about the venting?
The Apollo spacecraft's flying controls were something like those seen in this NASA test bed. This gimbal lock condition is related to the example we were looking at in MATLAB a moment ago. But in this case, in the NASA case, they were dealing with real physical gimbals. So let's have a look at physical gimbals and how they work. A gimbal is a simple mechanism that's used to keep a delicate instrument like a compass or a clock level when it's mounted on a vehicle or a vessel that's undergoing considerable motion. And the first example here is a compass in what we call a two-axis gimbal. So the compass can rotate around this particular axis, and then that whole assembly rotates around this axis. So if the base of the compass was mounted on the ship and the ship is rolling and pitching, then the compass is going to remain level. The same for this clock indicated here. It's first free to rotate around this axis, and then it's free to rotate around this axis. If I place this box on the table in my cabin on board a sailing ship, then the clock is going to remain level even though the ship is undergoing quite considerable motion. This last example is a little bit more complex. It contains what we call a three-axis gimbal. So in the first case then, the compass is free to rotate around this axis, and then that whole assembly is free to rotate around this axis, and finally, all that inner assembly is free to rotate around this axis. Gimbals are widely used in engineering systems, and this is a schematic of a gimbal that was part of the navigation system for the Apollo lunar module that was referred to earlier in the movie. The key component is what's called the stabilized platform, and it consists of three gyroscopes spinning quickly, and they keep this particular assembly shown here in blue at a fixed orientation with respect to the universe. Now, because the vehicle in which it's mounted is going to be rotating and translating, then we need some way to mechanically connect the spacecraft to the stable platform, but in such a way that the motion of the spacecraft does not introduce any torque or force on the stable platform. So the way we do that is to use a series of gimbals. So the first gimbal is a rotation around this axis here, and then that whole assembly is free to rotate around this axis. And then finally, all that assembly is free to rotate around this axis. What this allows is really important. If we measure the angles of the shafts in each of the gimbals, then that tells us the orientation of the vehicle with respect to the stable platform, and that's how this vehicle is able to determine its orientation in space. The problem occurs when the angle of the second gimbal approaches plus or minus 90 degrees, and that's the condition referred to as gimbal lock, which was mentioned in the movie clip. For spacecraft navigation, it works something like this. We have this inner element, which is referred to as the stable platform. It's got three orthogonal gyroscopes on it. And what that means is that the platform maintains a constant orientation with respect to the universe. It's a pretty impressive thing. The spacecraft then is attached to the other side of the gimbal mechanism. So as the spacecraft's orientation changes over time, by reading the gimbal angles, we can determine the orientation of the spacecraft with respect to the stable platform, whose orientation is a constant. Let's consider the case where the orientation of the vehicle is expressed in terms of roll pitch yaw angles. We write this as a sequence of elementary rotations, a rotation around the x-axis by the roll angle, rotation around the y-axis by the pitch angle, and a rotation around the z-axis by the yaw angle. Now let's consider what happens when the pitch angle equals 90 degrees, or pi on 2 radians. We can write the expression like this. Now the pitch angle is equal to pi on 2, and with some well-known identities, I can rewrite it in this form. Now what we have is two consecutive rotations around the x-axis. So I can write this now as a single rotation around the x-axis, and the amount of the rotation is r plus y. It's the sum of the roll angle and the yaw angle, and there's a final constant rotation. What this indicates is that now roll and yaw are equivalent. We can't tell one from another. Another way to think about this, a mechanical way in terms of the gimbal mechanism itself, is to think that the axis of the first gimbal and the third gimbal are now parallel to each other and aligned. This is a mathematical representation of the gimbal lock phenomena. And it occurs when the angle of the middle gimbal approaches pi on 2. This is the condition that they were concerned about in the Apollo 13 clip. So what this means is that when you define your coordinate system for any particular vehicle, and if you want to describe its orientation in terms of roll, pitch, and yaw angles, it's important that the pitch angle is around zero for the nominal configuration of your vehicle. So if it's an aircraft, then the pitch angle would be zero when it is in the horizontal configuration. Whereas if it was a rocket, you would want to make sure that the zero pitch angle corresponded to the condition of going straight up. You need to ensure that the situation where the pitch angle equals plus or minus 2 does not occur during normal operating conditions.